This
today.
conference will now be recorded.
God bless you.
Thank you, my mother. Good morning. Good morning, the saints of God. How was your night? I believe you had a peaceful night rest. It is good to be awake, and it is good to be alive in the land of the living. And it is much more better to start our days at his feet, hearing his voice, adhering to his instructions. Then we take this song and we proceed. That is why you are called Jehovah. That is why you are called Jehovah. What you say you will do, that is what you have done. That is why you are called Jehovah. What he says you will do, that is what you have done. That is why you are called Jehovah. Yes, Lord, that's why you are called Jehovah. For what you said you will do for us is what you have done. You said you will guide us, and you've done that. You said you will provide for us, and you did. You said you will heal us, and you did exactly that. You said you will prosper us and the work of our hands, and you've done that. You said no weapon formed against us that shall prosper, and you have done that. You said we shall be the head and not the tail. You have done that. And we glorify your name. We magnify your holy name this morning. Thank you, the God of overdue. Thank you, the God that seated on his throne in the heavenly places. Lord, it is for your sake we are here on this platform this morning. Eager to hear you talk to us, eager to hear you speak to us and communicate your mind to us. Lord, do so and let your name be glorified. Bless us today as we look into the scriptures. In Jesus' name we have prayed, amen. All right, today is 17th day in October 2022, and we will be looking at our devotional today, but we will read from yesterday devotional lesson, and then we read today, and then sum it together and see what God has to tell us this morning. All right, I'm reading from the devotional of 16th October 2022, that is yesterday. The Word became human and made his home among us. That is John chapter 1, verse 14. The Gospel of John begins with a startling statement. In the beginning, there was the Word. The Word was with God, but the Word was also God. With him, yet also him, not another being. The essence of God himself. We don't understand such mysteries, but that's okay. Infinite minds shouldn't be able to understand an infinite being anyway. Still, we wonder, who is this Word? Why is he called the Word in the first place? What would someone known as the Word actually say? We know from John and the rest of Scripture that the Word is Jesus. He is the wisdom, the logo behind creation. When God spoke words into being, he spoke through Jesus, or he spoke Jesus. We aren't sure, however, it happened. Jesus was instrumental in creation, and he is one with God, and he is called the God, the Word. Though that mystery may raise many questions, it also tells us a lot. When Jesus became, he didn't just speak the truth. He was the truth, and being eternal, he still is the truth. That means that when we hear him, we aren't just receiving words of wisdom or good advice or even internally significant information. We are receiving him. We can't separate what he says from who he is. We can't talk about his nature and his voice as if they were two separate entities. Somehow, perhaps mystically, when we receive Jesus by faith and are born of his spirit, we are born of the Word. Truth is implanted within us. As we grow, we don't just learn his ways, we embody them. Perhaps that's what Jesus meant when he spoke of those who have ears to hear. He wasn't talking about receiving sound waves, but about embodying his nature and his truth. His voice doesn't come to us from outside, but from his spirit. When he has just put within us, as we embrace the Word, we embodied his words. Prayer, Lord, you became flesh and lived among us. Enter into my flesh and live through me among your people. Don't just speak to me, speak through me. Be the Word in me. Hallelujah. Let us, as we read the devotional for 17th October, 2022, the Saint John 1 verse 14. The Word became human and made his home among us. Throughout Hebrew scripture, God tells us what he is like. He also shows his nature in his creation and in his dwellings with Israel, his chosen people. He revealed his truth and his purpose. He interacts with human beings and teaches us who he is. Then in Jesus, he came and demonstrated who he is. That's different. The Word living among us in person tells us much more than sporadic encounters with an invisible deity can reveal. If we look at the Word of God as a person rather than as verbal communication, we get a dramatic picture of God's heartbeat. So when the Word embodied in flesh made his home among us, what did he display? First and foremost, he is an expression of love. He was moved with compassion to heal people who were hurting. He cultivated loving relationship among his followers, between one another, and with God. And he made the ultimate sacrifice on behalf of all who would believe, laying down his life to restore us. The Word embodies love. If that's what the Word looks like in the flesh, that's also what the Word is going to sound like when he speaks to us today. His words will always be consistent with Scripture, but they will especially be consistent with the personality and presence of Jesus on the earth. There is no discord between the Father, Son, and the Spirit, nor is there any change in personality among them over time. The communication we receive from God today will have exactly the same flavor as the picture we see of the Word incarnate. God's ways to us will look and feel like Jesus. Never forget that. Many people do, receiving God through their own wounds and distorted emotional filters. But the Word is still passionately in love with his people. And any ways that doesn't express that love aren't his. He is still pouring out his radical, sacrificial, compassionate love into our lives. Prayer. Jesus, I so often assume that you are displeased and demanding, and my ears seem to fill in the blank with attitudes that aren't yours. Open my heart and my ears to your relentless love. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank God for the reading of the devotional. Now we are going to see what God has for us this morning. The scripture says in that John chapter 1, verse number 14, the Bible says, the Word became human and made his home among us. Beloved, the term Word is used in different ways in the Bible, especially in the New Testament. There are two Greek words, translated word. They are called Rhema and Logos. They have slightly different in meanings. Rhema usually means a spoken word. For example, in Luke chapter 1, verse 38, when the angel told Mary that she would be the mother of Jesus, Mary replied, "Behold, I am thy handmaid. I am thy servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." That word there is Rhema. Let it be to me according to thy word. That is Rhema. Logos, however, has a broader, more philosophical meaning. This is the term used in John chapter 1. It implies a total message to mankind. For example, in Luke chapter 4, verse 32, says that Jesus, when he taught the people, they were amazed at his teaching, because his word, that is Logos, had authority. His word, the Logos, had authority, and they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. The Logos, it was with authority. Child of God, the people were amazed, not merely by the particular ways Jesus chose, but by his total message. Now, the word Logos in this John is referring to Jesus. Jesus is the total message of everything that God wants to communicate to man. Don't mistake this. Don't misunderstand this. Jesus is the total message of hope, the total message of salvation, the total message of blessing, of all that God wants to communicate to man. Everything that God wants to communicate to man is found in Jesus. In other words, Jesus is the carrier of everything that God wants to communicate to us. So in the first chapter of John, gives us a glimpse inside the Father and the Son relationship before Jesus came to the earth in form of a human being. Jesus pre-existed with the Father. In verse 1 of that John, in the beginning was the Word. If Jesus is the Word, the Bible says in the beginning was the Word, meaning he pre-existed with the Father. And he was involved in the creation of everything. For verse 3 says, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. So he is the source of everything that was made. So he was involved in the creation of everything. Then in verse 4, he is the light of all mankind. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. In him was the life, and the life was the light of men. He is the light of all mankind. So the word Jesus is the full embodiment of all that God is. You can't separate Jesus from what God is. He is the embodiment of all that God is. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 19, the Bible says that Jesus Christ, Colossians chapter 1, verse 19, that for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. The him there is referring to the Word, which is Jesus. It pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Child of God, but God the Father is spirit. He is invisible to human eyes. So the message of love and redemption that God spoke through the prophets had gone unheeded for centuries. So people found it easy to disregard the message of an invisible God and continued in their sins and rebellions. So the message became flesh, look on human form, and came to dwell among us. It came to dwell among us for the purpose of accomplishing the reason why God released his word that became flesh in the person of Jesus. Now, the Greeks used the word logos to refer to one's mind, one's reason, or wisdom. And John used this Greek concept to communicate the fact that Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, is the self-expression of God to the world. In the Old Testament, the Word of God brought the universe into existence and saved the needy. So, in this John's Gospel of chapter 1, John was appealing to both the Jews and the Gentiles to receive the eternal Christ. Jesus told a parable in Luke chapter 20, verse 9 to 16. He told a parable. And in this John, in this Luke chapter 20, verse 9 to 16, it explained why the word had to become flesh. Now, a man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time journey. At harvest time, he sent a servant of his to the tenants so that they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him, sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, the second servant. They also beat him and treated him shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. He proceeded and sent the third servant. They as well wounded him and threw him out. Then the owner of the vineyard decided to send his own son. Now, what shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they would respect him. But when the tenant saw him, they talked the matter over. This is his heir, they said. Let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to these people? He will surely come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. So in this parable, Jesus was reminding the Jewish leaders that they had rejected the prophets and we are now rejecting the Son, which is the Logos. The word of God was now going to be offered to everyone, not just to the Jews, but to everyone. Because the word became flesh. We have a high priest who is able to sympathize with our weakness, and one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. That is what Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 15 says. Child of God, it is possible to know God with a limited revelation. It is possible to go to church. It is possible to be a Christian, and yet you know God with a limited revelation. And a lot of people are like that. They have a very myopic view of who God is. But you see, you can't live beyond the revelation of God that you have. Wherever the revelation of God that you have stops, that is where your life will stop. The more you know him, the more deeper you go in understanding his voice, in hearing his voice and understanding his voice. Child of God, in the Old Testament, God revealed himself in several names. He said to Moses, I am the God. I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, unto Jacob, by the name of El Shaddai. But by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. Exodus chapter 6, 2 to 3. That was what God told Moses. Child of God, in the New Testament, God revealed himself in the name Jesus. He revealed himself in the name Jesus. The Bible says the totality of divinity resides in Jesus Christ. The totality of divinity resides in Jesus Christ. So the name of God in the New Testament is Jesus. In Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, Jesus commanded the disciples to baptize the people in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In carrying out that divine instruction, they baptized people in the name of Jesus. Child of God, the book of Acts of the Apostles, in that book, the apostles understood that the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit is Jesus. And that is the name for the Godhead. The Father responds in that name. The Holy Spirit answers to the name as well. In the book of Psalms, chapter 138, verse 2, the psalmist declared, "For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name." In our text, John chapter 1, verse 2, we read it that the word became flesh and dwelt among us. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that is Jesus. That is Jesus. Philip chapter 2, the book of Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 says, "Wherefore God also had highly exalted him, giving him a name which is above every other name." So if the name of Jesus is higher than every other name, then it is obvious that name of God himself. That name is God himself. If the name of Jesus is higher than every other name, then it is obvious that is the name of God himself. He couldn't have a name that is lesser than the name of Jesus. This is the name that is being given to us to live by. All power, all dominion, all glory, all majesty is vested in that name. That name has the power to heal the sick. It has the power to cast out devils, to raise the dead, and work wonders in that name. That name got all of heaven's authority behind it. Wow! Glory be to God. How powerful the word is. How glorious the word of God is. This is talking about Jesus Christ himself. It's talking about God himself. The scripture says, "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God." What do we need to understand here further? The Word of God is self-sufficient. The Word of God is powerful. And the Word of God is potent. The only thing the Word of God cannot do is what God cannot do. Whatever God can do, his Word can as well do it. And the more or the faster we understand this, the better for us to go deeper in our relationship and in our revelation of whom God is. The only thing the Word of God cannot do is what God cannot do. And lo and behold, there is nothing God cannot do. There is nothing God cannot do. He is a protocol breaker. There is nothing God cannot do. He is the God of overdue. I have tested all his power. I have tested all his love. He is the God that does everything that he wishes to do for us. And hear me this morning. God is about to do something for us. He's about to break yoke in somebody's life. He's about to give us new future, new hope. He's about to lift burdens. He's about to put smiles on our faces. He's about to do something that you feel cannot be done. He's about to cause you to shine again, even in the midst of darkness. For there is nothing he cannot do. Child of God, whenever you doubt God's word, you are doubting God himself. As we hear his voice, as we go through the scriptures, if you have any doubt in you, you are doubting God himself. Because God is his word. He is in his word. And his word is in him. God's voice is in his word. And the voice of God is in the word. Unless the word of God is sent, the power of God has no ministry in the life of any individual. Unless God's word is sent, the power of God has no ministry in that very situation, in that very circumstances. Remember what the Bible talks about Joseph. He was still reminded in the court of the prison until his word came. And when his word came, the king sent for his loose. The ruler of the earth sent for his release because his word came. Today, this word is coming for someone here. This word is coming for your blessing. This word is coming for your miracles in the name of Jesus. In summary, I want to say that for the power of God depends on the operation of the word of God. In summary, I'm saying this, God's power depends on the operation of his word. Anyone who wants to operate with and in the power of God must pay attention to the word of God. If you want to operate in the power of God, you must pay attention in the word of God. Jesus Christ, the word of God, came to validate the power of God and to prove that indeed he was the word of God. I take this again. Jesus Christ, the word of God, came to validate the power of God and to prove to us that indeed he was the word of God. In the beginning was the word. The word was with God. The word was God. He dwells among us to correct our errors. He dwells among us to correct our mistakes. He dwells among us to open our understandings, to know who God really is, to know the extent of his love and care for us. He dwells among us to bring us out from darkness and place us in the place of divine light. He dwells among us for a transformation in our lives. I pray that God has spoken to somebody today, and may his word be richly blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. I pray for our families, the mountain of family I lift up before the throne of grace. Lord God Almighty, heal our families. Lord God Almighty, bless our families. Lord God Almighty, break yokes over our families. Lord God Almighty, all the forces and the powers contending with the peace and the blessing and the progress of our families today, let them, O God, be destroyed in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that our families will enjoy your peace. Our family will enjoy your love. Let your word, O God, King of glory, we have heard today be transmitted into our families. That today, that family that is about to collapse will no longer collapse. That family that is about to die will no longer die. That family that's been facing challenges, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command those challenges be converted into a miracle. In the name of Jesus, let your hands forever and ever rest upon our families. This I request, trusting you've answered. In Jesus' name I have prayed. Amen. Thank you. Back to you, my mother.